Dr. Wilmot, it's just a pleasure to have him back here on the show. It's been several years, much too long, described by the Financial Times as a cult derivatives lecturer, an expert in quantitative finance and derivatives. Welcome back.
Hi, it's a pleasure to be back.
Why don't we start off today with The Money Formula? This is your latest tome, co-authored with David Orrell.
Well, it's meant for a more popular audience than my other books, which are really mathematical. The reader who has an interest in science, maybe once upon a time did a bit of mathematics, but not necessarily, but wants to know about what's going on within the within high finance in terms of the scientific and mathematical base for how people trade or design new financial instruments. Because over the last few decades, the entire finance industry seems to be moving increasingly towards using the ideas of mathematics and statistics. And you can't do anything really in finance these days without having a, well, in many cases, having a PhD. Not always, but often you need a PhD in some, you know, scientific or mathematical discipline. So that's what the book is about, in a nutshell. But it's not just a history book. It also explains about the dangers within finance and risk management.
This is a fascinating topic. It's actually near and dear to me as well. It was the subject of my humble PhD dissertation. The way in which financial engineers have a tendency to delude oneself with this almost above human-like ability to comprehend the markets. And when you really take a look at the data and you crunch the numbers, I think what we find is, and you've done just an eloquent job of outlining this in your recent, not just recent, but in all of your work, it's not so simple. In fact, these markets are highly complex. And just at the moment that one thinks the equation has encapsulated all of the variables, there's that black swan moment that comes out of left field. Tell us more.
One gets the impression that financial engineers, particularly, I wish I were in physics, I wish I were doing quantum something or other. What they seem to try to do is to come up with theorems and laws and whatnot that try to describe how the financial markets and economies work in a physics-like way. Now, of course, human beings don't necessarily obey, they don't obey any laws, literally. And figuratively. These models that economists and quants create are sort of appealing because they feel a bit like physics, and they may be elegant like physics. But maybe they make the economists feel, you know, somehow equal to clever physicists, Nobel Prize winning physicists. But the reality is the models don't do what they're told. And you may get a totally false sense of security by using these physics-like models. Now, this is completely crazy to me because I come from a fluid mechanics background, and fluid mechanics, when you're doing fluid mechanics research, you're basically given the equations. The equations you work with are the Navier-Stokes equations.
Navier-Stokes, that's a favorite. You really use triple integrate.
Those equations, you can't really argue with them because they're based upon conservation of mass and conservation of momentum. And you basically Newton. So you can't, it's not like you can say, well, I don't think fluids behave like that. I'm going to come up with a different model because fluids do behave like that. End of story. Whereas in finance and economics, you've got so much more scope for doing creative things. So really, it ought to be the other way around. It should be that physicists and applied mathematicians should be jealous of economists and jealous of financial engineers because in finance and economics, we've got so much potential for doing creative things, which actually you don't necessarily have in physics. You're looking for the laws, but you don't have that much flexibility, really, in where you can look. So it's almost the wrong way around. I wish economists and financial engineers would just have a little bit more confidence in their own fields and not trying to make it like physics.
You've covered a lot of bases there, and it, again, has just happened to be something I'm fascinated by. I actually did a little bit of humble work here on the Navier-Stokes, and where we use triple integration to attempt to model it, and I'm sure you're familiar, there's a rather hefty prize being offered for folks who can crack open by Clay Institute up in New England, a $1 million prize.
Clay, as I say, the Clay Institute has prizes for several different...
Yeah, the Millennial Prizes.
Yes, they have several, and they have a list of which are the open open prizes. Most of them are highly pure abstract mathematics. As far as I recall, it's only the Navier-Stokes equation, which is the only open question, really, in applied mathematics.
P versus NP, that's a bit more of a computational problem. That, of course, the traveling salesman, P versus NP, is one of the Millennial Prizes still open. But I think you're right. It wouldn't really qualify as pure mathematics. So what I did want to touch on, because you did bring this up, and I think it's really pertinent to the discussion today, this concept of physics and mathematics being more of a concrete field, where Einstein's field equations, when you delve into them, you see that gravity behaves exactly as expected. Of course, until we get to the quantum level, right? But this is, I think, the takeaway I'd like for our audience to have today, that economics and finance are far less predictable. In my little body of work, I try to point out that there are contingency plans that can be put in place to help one navigate through such a complex investing environment. Would you like to comment on that, or is that outside your purview?
That's fine. I think that's the place where the scope for creativity lies. You can say you're an economist, you can say, well, I'm going to assume everybody behaves the same, or I'm going to assume everybody behaves rationally, and then come up with some theorem or laws. Or you could say, well, I'm going to work with the fact that people do behave irrationally. I'm going to work with statistics. Or you could say, well, I know that certain part of of the world where people do behave rationally, then there's a part where people toss coins. And then, you know, there's a part of humanity which they would just do the wrong thing just for the, and trying to understand all of that means having to understand human nature and bring together human nature and maths and finance and economics. I think that is such a wonderful field. But economists are actually trying to iron out all of the wonderful human bits. And I think they're missing a great opportunity there.
I think you've bifurcated the discussion here into A, perhaps economists are missing the point. These markets are just a wee bit beyond our current ability to model them. B, this remarkable opportunity for creativity. I mean, and I think you've done such a good job, obviously, in your work, outlining the opportunities within the derivatives field, options and futures, and let's say diversifying away risk from many aspects of business and investing. Please tell us more.
I think economists have a problem that they heard. It's very difficult if you're an academic and you want to do something different from your peers. It very rapidly gets disowned. And so it's very difficult for economists, if they want to keep their job, to not. That's one problem. But I think we do have lots of tools. And in the book that David and I have written, there's one part where we actually talk about fields that was fashionable just before quantitative finance became fashionable. Now, quantitative finance became big. Well, it was big in the States, in business schools. It took a while before it hit the UK, and also before it became big in math departments. Before it was big in math departments, one of the hot topics was mathematical biology. Great, great field. My brother actually did his doctorate in mathematical biology, but it's something where, again, you're trying to model some things that aren't certainly rational. And you can't talk about, if you try to model, for example, populations of lions and gazelles. Now, lions eat gazelles. The more gazelles there are, the more there are for lions to eat, and lion population grows, etc. But as it grows, well, then they start to eat more gazelles, and the gazelle population dies off, but then, as a consequence of lion population, you can see the sort of interesting dynamics you have there. And of course, mathematical biology encompasses diseases as well, or diverse topics. And there it's not unlike how finance or economics should be, in that you're never really expecting to predict exactly the lion population. It's more like you've got a toy model which explains it more qualitatively. And so finance and economics could use a lot of the tools that people in mathematical biology have been using. They have to understand that their models are never going to be perfect. They're toy models that may inspire you to how to control interest rates to have some effect, rather than, you know, some central bank will say, come up with a prediction for growth in next year. A month later, they change the prediction. It's worse than weather forecasting. Why did they bother making a forecast in the first place? They never put error bounds on. At least in weather forecasting, certainly, well, not so much in the UK, but in the other side of the Atlantic, you always hear the chance of rainfall is in the UK. We're still, it will rain tomorrow. It didn't. You should have put a percentage to it. That's your get-out clause. So you can do exactly the same with finance and economics, toy models, expect them to work approximately, but never to be precise.
We tend to have these linear models. As an undergraduate, I took quantitative, as you said, and it's ironic, in the business school, quantitative finance in the business school. It was not offered in our mathematics department. The models that we had at that time, although it has morphed a bit lately, were primarily linear, and linear just does not model human behavior or gazelles and lions, as you put it. So that's certainly a constraint that we have.
That is one of my favorite topics, is the non-linearity. Yeah, the world is non-linear. Everything is non-linear. Business is non-linear. When you buy one beer, it costs you a certain amount of money. If you buy a crate of beer, it costs you, you know, per bottle, it costs you less. There's all sorts of things that one experiences just from going down to the supermarket that is not in this quadrillion-dollar business. You think that it's going to be a quadrillion, one followed by 15 zeros, dollars worth of complex derivatives out there, they'd at least be, you know, more statistically. But everything is assumed to be linear, which means that, hey, if we're making $1 from selling one of these contracts, if we sell 10 of them, we make $10. If we sell a million, hey, what if we sell a billion? What if we sell a trillion? Changing the world economy, and you haven't realized that actually selling a trillion of something might not be a good idea.
It sounds ominous. It looks as though you feel the system might be doomed to its own by its own success.
Well, the problem is that it is. There are all sorts of issues. All sorts of issues. I mean, we could talk about regulators. We could talk about moral hazards. We could talk about all sorts of different issues. But everything is pointing in the same direction, which is people, bankers, are trying to get as much money out of the system on whatever is the latest bandwagon, as quickly as they can before either regulators step in or something blows up. And that's kind of the game. And a lot of the time, mathematics can be used to help them in this game. If someone comes up with a model which says, hey, there's no risk, they love that. They love that because if the model says there's no risk, they can trade more and more and more and more and more. Of course, the model has got risk. It is that they are managing to fool people that their model says there's no risk.
I think you've also pointed out that sometimes people make irrational decisions. My background in economics, we spend so much time trying to discuss utility and this idea of rational thinking, but there are times when the herd does not behave as expected. The linearity, as you say, goes right out the window.
Well, the latest I mentioned bandwagons. I think that the latest bandwagon, probably computer trading, algorithm trading, high-frequency trading, and the human trading decision. And I don't see that as a very good thing at all. Trading is happening on a short and shorter time scale. The link between the price you see in the market and the value of some share starting to will disappear. And it just feels like another one of those bandwagons that's not going to end well. But from a banker's perspective, any bandwagon is good. They just have to, as much money as possible while the bandwagon still has its wheels.
You know, this is interesting as well, because I spent several years with automated trading using MetaTrader, and we could deploy as many as 20, you might call them robots, but they're just programs. We called them robots, robotic systems on different currency pairs from, let's say, the euro dollar, arbitrage at very fast speeds. All you really had to do is make sure the system was working properly and it didn't blow up. And I can see where your concerns are there, because it, on the positive side, it removes the human emotion from the scenario. There's zero oversight there. And I think that's what you're really leading up to here. You're concerned that we have this sort of aha wake-up moment where the machines are running the show. What does that lead to?
It ceases to become relevant what the value. You have to distinguish the value of something and the price of something. The value, something that the price is meant to kind of cover or bounce around. Because in the market, so you just price it, you don't really know what the value is. But the value of a share of a company does matter to the people who work there. You know, if the value of a company collapses, that's going to have some impact on the people who work there. If the computers are doing all the trading, the value, all they care about is, oh, I can buy it for this and I can sell it a second later for a little bit more. It becomes irrelevant what the value of the company is, and ultimately the value of the employee is, what their value is. If all it is just computers playing games with each other.
Brings up an interesting point, and maybe you would have some comments here. If, for instance, we were talking about earlier the difficulty of modeling complex systems such as human behavior, or let's say human responses to economic activity, corporate earnings reports, things of this nature, let's say economic shocks, externalities. If that is difficult to model, what happens when 70% of the volume of the New York Stock Exchange is robotically controlled? Does that put some constraints on the system and make it more easy to model? And what would be the ramifications?
Well, that reminds me of a story going back a couple of decades now. But I was browsing through a university library, and I don't know what I was originally looking for, but I came across a book. It was called something like the UK Treasury's model of the British economy, something like that. And it was about an inch or so thick, this book, and it had. My memory is it had 770 equations, 770 different equations that were supposed to represent the economy. All pretty linear, or maybe there was occasional logarithm or exponential, but nothing too complicated. 770 equations. As an applied mathematician, I know that anything like that is going to have chaos coming out of the other end. It's going to be useless for prediction. You're never going to know what the parameters in this thing are. But really, what you ought to do is say, take the 770 equations and whittle it down to the key half a dozen. Get 6 equations out of this that are robust, which give you ballpark where, interest rates or whatever is going. But I know that the economists who were looking at this thing were thinking, the reason why we don't get the answers right, why we can't solve it, is because we need 771 equations.
You've hit the nail on the head. I can share a very brief story here as well. Having worked through well over 1,200 different trading robots for the markets, what one finds very quickly is robustness is the key, because there's so much cherry picking, is what traders would call it. You find out very quickly, without that robust character, I think I found 2 that actually held up out of those 1,200, and we still use the same models today. I did my best in my dissertation to point out, look, there are some very simplistic ways to increase the robustness of your models and would keep this whole house of cards from imploding. And would you care to discuss your interesting formula that you've brought up in the past with the modulus and absolute values that keeps one from falling into the trap of linearity?
When I first started working in quant finance in the late 80s, we were doing lots of things with Black Scholes. And then somebody suggested to talk about transaction costs. When you have a derivative, the key to valuation, and this is the Nobel Prize winning Black-Scholes-Merton idea, the key to valuation is that you buy your option and then you sell in place, you sell some of the stock. And you do this on a continual basis, which sort of dynamic hedging. By doing that, you can eliminate risk. You don't care whether the stock goes up or down, because if the option goes up, well, the stock goes down and I'm balanced. I'm risk-free. But the problem with this, buying and selling stock for hedging purposes costs money. You've got to bid off a spread. Elizabeth Worley and I did lots of work on transaction costs. And it turns out it's a non-linear equation. It's like the Black-Scholes equation, but it has a non-linear term, as you mentioned. One of the first times there's been a non-linear equation in quantitative finance. And then thereafter, there's been other people doing work ending up with non-linear equations, and that's what we mentioned earlier. Non-linearity just captures something about the real world, but the popular models don't. But we have here a problem. They're harder to solve. You have to actually do some number crunching. You have to do some serious coding. It's not just a case of putting it into a calculator, like with the famous Black-Scholes thing. People are reluctant to do that. They're reluctant to do hardcore programming to try out different models, particularly nonlinear models. And it's one of my particular complaints I have is that, especially in interest rates, people tend to choose their models that they use for valuation because they are simple, because they've got a nice formula. So rather than having to write a lot of complicated code, they have a formula. So they choose the interest rate model that is simplest. not necessarily the most accurate, the simplest. Now, considering how many trillions of dollars goes to interest rate products, it seems a bit strange relying on a formula that you choose because of its simplicity rather than its accuracy. It would be like, and the analogy I often use is going back to Navier-Stokes. So suppose you were designing an airplane and you had to deal with the Navier-Stokes equation. Well, the Navier-Stokes equation is nonlinear. Oh, I don't like nonlinear equations. Let's cross off this term from the equation because if I cross this off, it's so much easier. And then you design the plane and of course the plane crashes. Couldn't get away with this in any other field except finance. Only in finance can you choose a model so that it's easy to use rather than it's accurate.
Yes, and only in finance could one win the Nobel Prize and then blow up long-term capital management a few years later. Other folks in the field who have comments on Dr. Wilmot's money formula here. This book has humor, attitude, clarity, science, common sense, pulls no punches, takes no prisoners. That's Dr. Nassim Nicholas Taleb, one of our favorites here. High praise indeed from a father of modern quantitative analysis here. It was costly. I was going to say he's not one to shell out compliments. I was wondering just how many dinners or lunches or coffees that required. Anything you'd like to add about the money formula before we wrap up?
Other than buy it and give us a great reviews on Amazon? I think covered that quite well. Thank you very much.
Well, we appreciate you making time for us today. We know that you have a very busy schedule and look forward to your next must-read tome, which I'm sure we'll be able to find as well on Amazon.com.
A pleasure. Thank you very much.